Just an unbelievable statistic. 1 in 8 people around the globe are illiterate. 770 million illiterate adults in emerging nations. You say we fix the problem, John, in developed countries, so it's largely ignored.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, in most of the advanced societies of the world, you have literacy rates that are north of 90%. And it's not that the education systems are perfect, but when you go to rural Ethiopia, rural Cambodia, rural South Africa, you notice a profound lack of books, a lack of libraries, right? I mean, Andrew Carnegie built 3,000 libraries across North America, one of the greatest philanthropic investments of all time. Yet throughout the developing world, they don't have books, they don't have libraries. And as a headmaster in Nepal once said to me, we're too poor to afford education, but until we have education, we'll always be poor. And that's really what I'm and my organization, RimReader, are trying to address.
You left a high-profile, high-paying job at Microsoft about a decade ago to start this program. The single mission here, teach people to read. Yeah, why this mission?
Room to Read was started because a headmaster in Nepal showed me an empty library. He had 500 students. They had no books. And I thought, how can this be in this day and age? And I had been fortunate enough to make some money at a young age at Microsoft. And I thought, this is a great chance to pay back these lottery winnings, do something socially useful with them. But what I realized quickly after doing the first library in Nepal is that this needed to be a large project, right? The world, you know, with 770 million illiterate people, the world needs thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of libraries. And in our first 10 years, we've already reached 4 million kids.
Your goal this year is ambitious, raising $30 million. We're still in the middle of the recession. People are tightening their purse strings, whether you're talking about corporate donors or just the individual. I mean, how are you going to achieve that?
Well, we're very fortunate at Room to Read, and we have a great, great support from the technology world, from the banking world. You know, our largest single source of support are the partners of Goldman Sachs, who collectively give a lot of money to help Room to Read. The biggest corporate investor is Barclays Capital. Credit Suisse gives us money and gives us free office space around the world. So
those aren't headlines you see associated with the big banks these days.
Yeah, I sometimes think the big banks get a bad rap because some of the most generous people I know are bankers. Some of the most generous people I know run hedge funds.
You've talked and written a lot about the fact that you think to be a successful nonprofit, you have to run it more like a business. So how are you doing that at Room to Read?
Number one is set, you know, the big, hairy, audacious goal. From day one, I've said Room to Read wants to reach 10 million children with a lifelong gift of literacy across the developing world. And that, you know, the business world thinks in bold goals. Many times the charity world doesn't. So that's number one. Number two, performance-driven culture. Room to Read, every year, we publish in advance of the year our goals for the year, and then we publish our updates quarterly. Just like a public company reports to their investors, we do the same thing. We opened our 10,000th library a couple of months ago in Nepal. We were very psyched about that milestone. We celebrated for about a nanosecond, and we went right back to thinking about how do we get to 20,000 libraries.
And to do that, you need money. Social networking has been a big part of your fundraising. What's been most effective? Say a Twitter, a Facebook? What works, what doesn't when it comes to raising capital for a nonprofit using social networking?
Well, Room to Read is very fortunate in that Twitter picked us as their first corporate social innovation partner. And it was a bit of an unusual choice because Room to Read is a fairly low-tech solution, right?
It's building libraries. How did that happen?
Their team reached out to us, and you know, Biz Stone was quoted as saying, if kids can't read and write, they can't tweet. Social media has been very good for us for both brand awareness and also for fundraising.
You have a number of big backers. You talked about Twitter in terms of that cooperation, Nokia, Salesforce.com. What are the other big corporate players out there that you're targeting?
Well, we're targeting pretty much any company that is doing business, wants to do business, or is doing business in the developing world, right? The great thing about Room to Read is we're already in the markets of the future, right? India, huge growing market with 300 million plus illiterate people in one country alone. Vietnam, great market of the future. So as companies look to invest all over the developing world, whether it be South Africa or Vietnam or India, what we're doing at Room to Read is to say we'd like to be your CSR partner.
Yeah, well, isn't it interesting? I mean, you talk with businesses about where their hopes are now, and they say Russia, China, India, and yet those are the markets that need the most help when it comes to education, literacy, obviously Africa and other more impoverished nations, but it makes sense from a business standpoint, too.
It really does. And as companies invest in these markets, you know, even with India, for example, we've received support for our work in India from Goldman Sachs, from Credit Suisse, from Barclays Capital. And so as they invest in the business side, they're also investing in the business, the nonprofit side, the social side, through Room to Read.
Well, good luck and congratulations on the 10,000th library.
Thanks for having me.